Hello everyone. I hope anyone who wanted to visit this talk is already here. My name is Oleksij REMPEL. I'm working at Pingotronics. I'm part of Linux kernel hacker team. And I want to talk about one relatively common problem. I assume everyone knows this. If you have some kind of device which is powered and doing some things, and you unplug it or remove some battery power source, it may be not really happy about this. Sometimes it is so unhappy that it will not start anytime anymore. So I sent last year some patches and trigger some discussion, and there's still open questions how important is this problem and how this should be solved, and if there is a software part which should be involved in the solution, or it's only hardware which should solve this. So after this patches and the discussion, there was some echo triggered by Phronix. So I gathered some of common questions which will be probably better to discuss it or at least address it to explain what is the problem and why I think it's kind of important. So I'm starting just from basic, and the basic is that, there is a different kind of power disruptions, and main difference of this is the time, how long is it away, and the load of actual power consumer. So if they have some kind of tiny disruptions like microseconds, they usually can be addressed by proper design of power supply. For example, you add some just capacitors and they will make everything needed to not see this problem. If you have some longer disruptions, you probably will need some bigger capacitors. Probably you have seen this huge power supplies which can do almost everything. And if there is even longer disruptions, then probably you'll need to scale your providers, I don't know, starting with UPS or some diesel generator, or I don't know, power plant, or let's see what's needed. And well, I'm coming from embedded system area, and there's everything is tiny, and we can't just apply big solutions for small systems. Because, well, the size is important. Not everything will fit into your packet. We can't add huge capacitors to the smartphone. The cost is always important area. It will be, even you, if you buy some device, you will decide something what is cheaper but provide higher speeds and whatever. And embedded is always tiny and should be somehow cheap enough. At the discussion from last year, I got different suggestions like use these cool things and use RAID and use whatever. And in embedded, we just don't have place for all of this. So we have size constraints, we have special requirements for environment. For example, some devices will be really hot or have some temperature or dust resistance requirements or whatever, or vibration, for example, in automotive areas. It should be, like I said, cost effective. Every cent counts. even in industrial. And there's one more thing which just was visible last year. So there's supply chain disruptions, and we just can't always get what we want. And even if there's really cool devices which can handle everything, sometimes they are just not available. So we need to go to second or third choice and get whatever storages or components we can get. In my talk, most affected systems are embedded designs, which usually lack of own battery backup system or whatever. And as at this point, which I wrote this, I really believed in this assumption. And at this summit, I learned that this is not the case because, well, batteries can be removed by user. And by design, vendors should really care about these use cases. So if your smartphone is still enabled and user decides just to remove battery, then the smartphone design should be prepared for this use case. And there's, except of smartphones, there's a lot of different devices which can be affected by this issue. In embedded use case, we usually use other type of storage. Well, SSDs are actually built of raw NANDs, but in embedded, we just use only directly raw NAND or directly eMMC or some other tiny components. And in depending on technology which is used, we will have different issues, and it will be have different effects on the end of this power disruption case. Many probably of you know, so if you use a SD card in your design, and this probably will end somehow not good because it will just stop to functioning. As I sent these patches, there was people who said, well, there's new designs, and these designs handle under voltage cases, I mean power disruption cases, very well. And yes, I can confirm it. There are vendors which document these cases. I hope this really works. But many of our customers just learn from the past and don't believe it and integrate always some backup solution, because if you assume that it will work and at the end it will not work, then it will be really expensive. For example, in case of automotive industry, you'll just get millions of cars back just to replace this parts, and it's not really acceptable. This kind of many of solutions which I've seen, all of them have a software component, and this software component exists like in some BSP in form of downstream kernel patches. And well, we want to have it upstream. Want to have it available for everyone. So not everyone invent the wheel from the start. Yeah, this is mainly the same which I explained. Some about NAND here, we have better experts than me. We had some kind of cases where NANDs needed to be used in designs. Even if you have EMCs, which are in many cases better somehow, we still need to use NANDs in some designs because transporters for which are carrying some dangerous products which may go in flame and whatever. In this kind of systems, we are not allowed to use storages for power like capacitors or so. And in these cases, there are requirements, was at least requirements to use NANDs and so on and so on. We really have seen interesting issues, like if we don't pull write protection pin if under voltage event or if at power loss event, then this NANDs had corrupted sectors, and this was really not good issue. In case of EMMCs, there was some similar issues. Again, in automotive sector, usually there is sometimes even worse problem with power supplies, which is not seen always directly, because if you have a car, you start ignition, and sometimes the battery is not full enough, then you have some power spikes, and your infotainment system, which is directly supplied from these power lines, will just go high and down and so on. And in some cases, you have seen really nasty issues that EMMCs was so badly broken, and at the end, it was just brick instead of usable system, and nobody want to have this. And even in this case, the solution was really cheap. You just need to add some software component, and which will react on power loss under voltage event, and to send a shutdown signal to the EMMC and say, okay, from now we do not want to do anything. So to make more clear what my current problem is, that I implemented part of the solution, which I believed was good enough. In current state, we have in kernel upstream a regulator framework, and you can assign, or you can mark one of regulators as a system critical, and this system critical regulator, if it will get an under voltage event interrupt, then this regulator will call the shutdown, hardware protection shutdown. And mostly it is good enough, but it is not reproducible enough, because typical shutdown process of the Linux kernel will just take apart everything what was built on and the boot of the system. So the EMMC driver or storage driver will be just outside of the available window as long as power is provided. For example, in my current case, I have a window of 100 milliseconds. It is just some capacitor on the board, and as soon as power loss is detected on the input of the board, they have 100 milliseconds to react. And on the software side, we just starting hardware shutdown protection, taking everything apart, and well, in some cases, just storage shutdown is outside of this window. So it is too late. We are not able to react anymore or doing proper thing. And my current problem was to make it react earlier. I tried different solutions. One of solutions was to attach regulator framework directly to driver. For example, in this case, storage driver is the consumer for the regulator, and if regulator detects under voltage event and it's system critical, the regulator framework can pass this critical event to the consumer driver, and driver will be able to react somehow. For example, send a shutdown command or whatever. This was not generic enough, so I tried other solutions. So I reworked kernel shutdown process and added shutdown prioritization, which is interesting as well, but is not acceptable because it is too intrusive to the shutdown process. So everyone will be somehow affected by this. And who knows what kind of bugs I will trigger. But at least it worked for my use case. So generally, most of solutions which I have seen till now, I mean, in the form of patches and different downstream base pairs and so on, it is the same pattern. There is under voltage detector, and there is some software component which is reacting to this. In most cases which I have seen, this was a kernel part which reacting to this, but I already heard that at least some companies have user space which is reacting to this. In my case, I was not convenient enough that user space will be able to do anything usable in this 100 millisecond window. And I have already heard in this summit that some people have even less time, even 40 milliseconds. So it will be good to find something which will make everyone happy. Yeah, here I have listed paths which I think will be usable for the solution. Some of them are already upstream. The regulator framework extension is already upstream. We are executing hardware protection shutdown with some notification that there is under voltage hardware protection shutdown. The exact reason why things happen, like hardware protection, they can be different. For example, there are reasons like over temperature hardware protection shutdown, or over current hardware protection shutdown, or in this case, under voltage hardware protection shutdown. And except of just protecting things which may break, there is at least nice to have a marker for forensic or whatever reasons to let the system know that previous system state was not clean. For example, I decided to use RTC clock, and some RTC clocks have some scratch path, like 8-bit, which is enough for my use case, so I can just put some information to this and say, last time was not so good. And there's usually not really much room to react to this information, but at least you can gather some statistic, and maybe if your device was really broken after this kind of event, you will be able to understand what actually happened. For example, if the current implementation of under voltage hardware protection shutdown is not working properly because of, well, shutdown procedure made storage device shutdown too late, then you'll probably need to know this somehow. So at least, like I said, there was two options which I tried to implement last time. One of these revoked the kernel reboot sequence or kernel shutdown sequence. So the implementation was device tree specific, and it will not make users with ICPI systems happy. But with device tree, I will be able to say, okay, this exact devices have highest priority. For example, not every storage device has highest priority, but at least the boot storage has highest priority. And you will be able to write this information to the device tree. But it is not really a good place for device tree, because device tree describe device and not the policy. The second part of this implementation that was that the priorities should be inherited. So if there is child devices or child drivers based on the main, for example, if you have the MVRT or whatever child device on base of EMMC driver, then this priority should be inherited. And if we take apart the system, then first we should take apart the MVRT and then only then disable the EMMC. And well, in this kind of implementation, I decided, well, if device tree is not really a good place for policies, then I'll define a just default policy for everyone and make like storage devices having highest priority for shutdown. The pros of this implementation, well, it was integrated solution, affecting everyone, and it is centralized, so there is no conflicts between different priorities, hopefully. Not that someone is in one framework making one priority and the second framework is making some concurrent priority, which will make the system even, again, not reproducible. And the cons of this solution was, well, it is relatively complex and will affect everyone. I will break probably someone's system. It will make maintainers' life complicated and still not really solved problem is priority assignment. So somehow should we assign these priorities to different components. Then there is some other way which actually exists in some drivers, just assigning register using register reboot notifier, so the driver is just registering this reboot notifier. This reboot notifier will be called from kernel power off function, and likely it will be called even before a driver shutdown sequence. So I'll get always somewhere in this area until many drivers will start registering different reboot notifiers, and there probably will be again the same problem. I have seen one of these reboot notifiers in MMC power sequence code. Well, it seems to work, but I want to have some kind of generic solution which makes hopefully everyone happy. Well, pros, existing mechanism, I don't need to invent anything new. It is flexible enough, so I don't need to bother some other maintainers just to agree with maintainer of the exact subsystem. Contrast, well, it is too much decentralized. There will be some conflicts in priorities, and the still not solved problem is how to assign actual priorities. So open questions are how to assign these priorities, how to make it device independent, how to make it work on a CPI-based system, how to make it reproducible for exact specific designs, and not to break like any other system. Yeah. And my hope in this talk is to find some suggestions from your side, what would make hopefully everyone happy and make it upstream.
Yeah. Any questions or comments?
Did you consider using kconfig so that every other people can select their priorities depending on their board or something?
Yes, the disadvantage is that in many cases they have one binary, kernel binary, but different boards.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll just insert here. The thing that I wondered was whether or not for your use case, just simply having something in SysFS that just simply sets an attribute at runtime on a block device might not be an answer. That relies on user space setting the priority, but presumably user space knows best what file systems or the use of that particular block device is most critical.
Yeah.
It's not automatic, obviously, but it's a way.
Yes, it is one of possibilities. One of disadvantages in this case is that if we have power loss before user space.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I have a question. Is the priority really your main problem? Because
I
actually, when I get a voltage low event, then it's an interrupt. Then it's completely asynchronous to all other I/O. And speaking about raw NAND, where all I/O is strictly synchronous, you have to find a decent way how to notify the synchronous I/O path of MDD using the asynchronous event about that the device now has to be put into a sane state. So all the priority thing is step two, but step one is you have to figure out for MDD, EMC, block devices, and whatever, a good interface where you can asynchronously stop synchronous I/O. That's actually, in my opinion, the hardest part, and this is where I see most hacks in vendor code. Because I'm seeing these problems too, and also all these hacks, and they're all horrible, but I don't have a nice solution.
Yeah. Yes. First of all, yes. I don't know if priority is the solution. Yeah. Maybe there is other better solutions. If I will address only block devices, then I will not be able to do something like marker for like last reset event marker like in NTC clock or something. But maybe I should research this problem too. Yeah.
Regarding whether priority is a solution, so we have already an hardware protection shutdown mechanism in the kernel, and we already have a way to shut down the EMMC, and it's already there, but it doesn't run too early enough. So if we work with what we have the two pieces. We can call hardware protection shutdown from the interrupt handler, and it will do the correct thing. If you are in an interrupt handler, it will queue it for later. It will not be immediate, but it will be queued. And we already have a reboot notifier that shut down the EMMC, but it runs too late. So with what we have a problem. And I think it's a good first step to ensure that what we already have in the kernel works correctly. And priorities make sense for me, because not everything is as important. And regarding putting it into the device tree, so we have drivers that have the reboot priority in the device tree. So GPIO restart, GPIO power off, these have a priority property that's used. And yeah, so it's not unheard of to specify it in the device tree. I don't know if Saravana is here. But he had added for the device tree these post init providers, which are used to break cyclic dependencies. And that's also a kind of policy that you put into the device tree in what order you should probe stuff. So why not have something in what order you should shut down stuff? So I don't really understand the logic that, yeah, don't do it in the device tree. We do similar stuff already in the device tree. And ACPI can always do this kind of property encoding things that they use, for which you have this FW node API. They can do that if they want it.
Yeah.
Thank you.
You, the next one.
Where was the question? Yeah. Who wanted the mic?
I have here a raised hand, and the blue button.
Yeah.
Ah, someone's
is that all right?
Remote. Yes. Turn on your camera and you can ask your question.
Yeah. One sec. So. Right. I wanted to ask. So in the MMC, for example, there's this HPI thing, high priority interrupt, that cancels any active data transfer and or write thing or even read. So that would be a thing. But the latencies are like even for a simple write are like 250 milliseconds. So I assume that's like way out of the picture. It's hard for me to follow you if that's actually like a priority thing when we start the procedure, or is it actually the storage device taking too long for that to happen? Because that just wasn't really clear to me now.
Not just use other words. I didn't completely understood your question. Can you please?
So we have for example the shutdown notification, but also HP. We can cancel anything ongoing with EMC that is synchronous using an HPI. That is, you can look at how supported it is in the driver, and I don't know if you trigger it. But if you do, we are talking about like the spec allows the device like 250 milliseconds at least to like finish with this operation, which to me seems like way out of your scope, right?
Potentially.
So is the problem actually, when we talk in terms of priority, is the problem actually you starting the procedure too late, or can you guarantee that is not your issue? That's what I don't quite follow from so far.
In current implementation, which I did, the issue was that the calling shutdown is imminent command to sending this command to the MEC was just too late. It was already at the system which was already down. There was no power more. And with reshuffling the priorities, I'm able to call it early enough. I will still have like 50 milliseconds left. Is it the answer which you asked for?
Yeah, I think so. I'm not sure if that includes like waiting for anything ongoing on the device, or if canceling that is like part of your setup or your experiment, or if we can, you know, start earlier, not because of priorities, but because of doing the actual cancellation right, like using the HPI command for EMMC, for example. But maybe I can contact you offline or find the code actually. Thank you.
I just wanted to point out, I think there's currently a confusion in the discussion regarding shutdown. So on one side we have shutdown, the driver call of the driver core subsystem that is called on the driver. Here you need the priorities to get the shutdown function called on your driver fast enough. And then we have the shutdown command of, for example, the storage device, the EMMC.
Yeah.
And I think that was kind of the root cause of the discussion. Speaking about the shutdown in the driver core, we have already, for example, in the MD subsystem, calls for a panic write that's used for MDD oops, where the kernel is crashing, that the NAND device has to write something immediately. So we could also add a new callback, shutdown immediately.
Okay.
And I don't think you have to tie this dead core in the driver core with the shutdown stuff. Just implement something that from the storage device, this immediately shutdown callback can be called immediately.
Okay.
Like we do in the panic write.
Okay.
But this discussion is up to Greg, and he is the driver core maintainer. Is he here?
Greg Cage?
Yeah.
He's outside.
It should be here. Thanks.
Yeah, I mean, I'll note that what might make sense is what you put in the device tree is some sort of indication of, you know, what are the requirements of the device to, you know, how much latitude does it need to shut down the device so that it can be safe, right? I mean, my interpretation of the problem is, you know, more expensive flash devices are power fail certified, so it doesn't matter if you drop power to them, but if you have very, very low-end flash, if the flash translation layer doesn't write out all of its flash metadata, you can actually lose a lot of data, right? And it, the main issue is you want to tell the flash translation layer on the device, please get yourself into a safe zone, and you have 10 milliseconds, whatever the time budget is, to do that. And if the device tree had some way of indicating this device needs, you know, to be given at least 10 milliseconds grace period, this one requires 50 milliseconds, then the kernel could prioritize the order in which devices get told you need to shut down so that the right thing can happen, right? Because I think the traditional problem is the way traditional storage engineers solve this problem is you put enough capacitors in your power supply that you have at least, you know, n seconds of time, because typically you're trying to get the user space to also write and get the database into a sane state, and then you shut down the file system, and then you shut down the device. Yeah. But it seems like the problem you're trying to solve is you don't have that kind of hardware, because this is for low-end devices where you can't afford that in your BOM cost.
Yes.
And the real issue is you really want to shut down the hardware device so that the flash translation layer, you know, can minimize data loss.
Okay.
Is that a fair summary of where what you're at?
Yes, and it's a good point, because for regulator, we have already device tree binding which describes how much time do we have.
Right.
So probably a binding which will describe how much this component has, or if this component is affected by, like, power fail, is it power fail affected component or something like this? And if yes, how much time it will have? This is then, in this case, it is a hardware description.
Yep. Any other questions or comments? I think this has been a good discussion. Okay. Don't see any. Remotely? On the chat?
Not look
so. Nope. All right. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.